HarperCollins and Harper Audio present If I Tell You the Truth by Jasmin Kaur. This is the author. For Gayatri, whose wisdom guided so much of this work. Trigger warnings. Sexual assault, police brutality, immigrant trauma, victim blaming, domestic violence, alcoholism, depression, anxiety. This story was imagined and written prior to COVID-19. For an in-depth discussion on how the pandemic would have affected protagonists Kiran and Sahaara, please listen to the notes section at the end of this book. If you wish to avoid spoilers about key plot points, do not listen to the notes section at the end of this book until you have already completed the novel. Some stories bury themselves so deep within the flowerbed of the mind that the earth trembles, throbs, when they are dug out. Deep breath in, deep breath out. You've done this before. You can work through a panic attack. Focus on something specific, something that can bring you back down to earth. I remember my daughter's eyes. They are oceans of deep brown, but if you catch them in the light, they are liquid amber. Round as my own and glistening with the hopefulness that is foreign to me, they are so very similar to another pair that still appears in my dreams. A pair of eyes that she will never meet, although their owner still breathes. She has a smile that digs deep into her cheeks, a smile that soothes my trembling hands more times a day than I can count. Her mess of wavy jet-black hair is just as unruly as mine. It frames honeyed brown skin that illuminates beneath the sun and hides a tiny rose-shaped scar just above her right ear. And then there's her jaw. It is a sharpened blade so unlike my rounded chin. I suppose I should confess that there are moments when the resemblance is too much, when, out of the corner of my eye, I think I see someone else hidden there. The man who has, unknowingly, placed me in the back seat of this police vehicle. Get in. August 2001 to March 2002. I wasn't exactly sure if this could be considered running away from home when my parents were the ones who put me on the flight and waved goodbye at the terminal. Go to school, study hard, come home. Don't get into any trouble in between. When I landed, the earth did not immediately shatter. And wasn't it dizzying how my aunt and uncle picked me up from Vancouver International Airport, and I made perfectly polite small talk all the way to Surrey, as though absolutely nothing was wrong. As though I could, in fact, be the girl Mom had always expected. The well-behaved girl. The masked girl. The studious girl. Who would go to school and then marry the perfect man from the perfect family just for her mother's nod of approval. As though I hadn't thrown up twice on the plane and rehearsed the phone call exactly 11 times. I still wasn't ready. I'd left Chandigarh, the only home I'd ever known, at the height of a humid August, with a tiny secret blossoming in my belly. And Canada greeted me with chilly wind, dry as bark against my unexpecting skin, as if the earth herself needed to remind me that nothing would be the same. Like morning sickness, choices felt foreign to my body. My parents' demands usually came packaged as suggestions. Biology is the best field to enter. Don't you want to be successful? Good families want foreign educated daughters-in-law with homegrown morals. You should study in Canada. Imagine how easy your life would be if you married into the Aluwalia family. Go meet their son for lunch. Get to know him more. The engagement doesn't need to be soon. Why don't you marry Prab after you finish your university program? When I missed my period, 2 weeks after, that day I needed to scrub from my mind forever. When I smuggled the pregnancy test from a shop where no one would recognize me. When I stared at that little plus, unblinking, unmoving. Something cracked beneath my chest. I knew I needed to make a decision, and quick. I knew that this decision could only come from me. The phone call home. There was no blueprint for it. No easy way to tell my mother the truth. When we were two icy continents who only knew each other from afar, I didn't know how to say that the boy I thought I loved had called me a liar. That his brother had done something I needed to burn from my memory. That my body had become an enemy I was forced to live with day and night. That I was terrified and shattering and ached to be held. That I needed my mom. So I simply spit out the two words she needed to know. I'm pregnant. What do you mean? I mean, I'm pregnant. This is why I told you to be careful when you were alone with Prab. It doesn't matter whether you are engaged or not. A man is still a man. I hesitated for a moment. I couldn't bring myself to tell her. The reason. When Mom asked whether I'd scheduled the abortion, it wasn't so much a question as it was a matter of fact. In what universe would her teenage daughter who had just crossed an ocean plan to raise a baby? She would never know how my frost-coated heart pined for someone to call its own. Lost and found. Between the pages of a story, I could hide from all of them and me. But in poetry, I found a mirror, a place where light could return to my chest. On this endless, tearful night, the sea of my stomach churned as I searched for rest in a bed that wasn't mine. And I tried not to shiver, thinking of the storm brewing in my mother. Slowly but surely, the star-drenched words of Hafiz and Rumi steadied my breath, asking me to trust that stiller waters could exist somewhere in this body. The morning after. My thumb traced over the words printed on yellow worn paper as a fresh tear betrayed me. Rumi's Sufi poem insisted that what I sought was also seeking me. I wanted, so painfully, to believe him. A fat droplet slipped through my fingers and landed directly on the guzzle. Over the months since the violation, it had almost become a ritual to cry into this book. Dried tears jutted from its pages like ribs peeking out from skin. Each tear was an emblem of a lonely night when I wanted to break free of my body. They were evidence of hurt, also proof that I could solidify and survive. I was seeking safety. If safety was seeking me in return, I would kiss its hands in gratitude. In my 18 years of existence, I'd never felt more alone, more vulnerable, more heart-shatteringly afraid. Last night, my aunt and uncle picked me up from the airport and drove me to their home in Surrey. Sitting in what would be my bedroom while I was living in Canada, I made the most terrifying phone call of my life. I told Mom that I was pregnant. My mom, as in Hardeep Kaur, as in the woman who once told me that I couldn't use tampons because they take away my virginity. There was no going back. No more delaying the inevitable series of catastrophes that would arise from her only child being pregnant out of wedlock. What was going through her mind? What was she doing? Where was she sending her earth-rumbling rage now that I was no longer in arm's reach? I dabbed at the fallen deer with my gray cotton sleeve and reluctantly closed the book's saffron cover. Its spine couldn't support me forever. Chachi had already knocked on the bedroom door twice, asking if I was ready for breakfast. It was nearly noon. With a sigh, I dropped the musings of Rumi among the perfectly folded junnis and jeans and hoodies sitting in my oversized suitcase. I would try to unpack later today. Perhaps it would help me settle into these new surroundings. Right now, I had to put on a show for Chachi. It wouldn't be long before she'd return to the door, wondering if everything was okay. I'd be forced to sit with her in the kitchen and make small talk without, A, bursting into tears because of the cells proliferating in my abdomen and my mom's burning anger and, well, my entire catastrophic life. B, projectile vomiting, courtesy of violent morning sickness. Two very difficult tasks, but if mom had prepared me for anything, it was holding it together before an audience. Composure, she would say. You keep your composure no matter what. Digging through neatly packed stacks of clothing, I carefully drew out a thick black shawl that could hide my blooming stomach. At nearly 3 months pregnant, I was starting to show. I mean, I didn't think I was showing until mom made those putrid comments outside the security gate at Delhi airport. In my mother's typical fashion, she went on a heated tirade about how I didn't look like a girl worthy of marriage into the Ahluwalia family. Kiran, you need less butter on your paratha and more sit-ups in your workout routine, she had said. At the acid of her words, I squeezed my nails into my sweaty palm, willing my tongue not to snap back. I was about to leave her and dad's side for the first time in my life. 4 years of university in Canada. 4 years of oxygen. 4 years to figure myself out without the fire of my parents' scrutiny hot against my skin. I sealed up the suitcase and stood, eyeing myself in an oval mirror that hung between a worn night table and a smiling portrait of my aunt, uncle, and the two young children. At the moment, my two little cousins were off at summer camp, and Chacha, Dad's younger brother, was dealing with insurance clients at his office. That meant Chachi was the only one home to see my tear-ravaged face. My insides crumpled at the thought of crying in front of her. It would almost be as bad as crying in front of my parents. Breathe, I told myself, glaring at my quivering bottom lip in the mirror. The more you cry, the worse your face is going to get. My dark moon eyes were already bloodshot and swollen and utterly embarrassing. Two sturdy knocks suddenly landed on the door. Kiran, Bertha, are you coming downstairs? Chachi called. Breakfast is ready. Well, it's lunch now, I suppose. Breath wavering, I dipped my tongue in false cheer. Hanji, I'll be down in a minute. With one last glance in the mirror, I reminded myself of all the hell I'd already faced. An awkward conversation was nothing. In the kitchen. Chachi's sleek black braid snaked down her spine, and she glanced back from the stove to smile and fret and remind me that it was okay to feel. Somehow, my bee-stung eyes didn't horrify her. It's perfectly human, my aunt said, to miss home, to miss your parents. Never feel ashamed of your tears. I nodded and lowered my gaze and didn't correct her assumptions about why I was in shambles. We couldn't be happier that you're staying with us. Our home is your home. Chachi was the day to my mother's night, kinder than necessary, softer than the rest of my rigid family. Even if I couldn't tell her the truth about everything hidden beneath my tearful smile, Perhaps I could find solace in her warm embrace. Biology major. Orientation day arrived, before I'd even managed to orient myself in time and space. I was a newborn to this new country, terrified of getting lost on the bus and finding my classes on my own and trying to make friends when I could barely do that back home. I knew why I had to be here.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.